I had a perfectly normal childhood. When my friends went out to play, I would often sit at home and wonder about Aghora Satya. When my classmates would worry about the division between girls and boys, I would worry about the division between Vaishnavites and Shaivites, all in the sixth grade. When I was 12, I went up to my English teacher and I asked her if death had a conscience. She looked at me and she said, "You're too young to be asking this question." And I was about this high, and I looked back at her, and I said, well, as per the theory of reincarnation of souls, the age of matter is but an illusion, and the age of the soul is actually unknown. So your argument is invalid, and you shouldn't be using that to lessen my inquiry. She nervously sipped her glass of water and enrolled me into creative writing. And and I never got the answer, but I was searching. Before I begin the journey of the spirit, we have to first understand death, finality. And to understand that story, let's look at the story of a little Brahmin boy. Once upon a time, a little Brahmin boy was walking through the village, and he heard a family crying over the loss of a loved one. So the boy went up to them, and he said, "Why are you crying?" They said, "This person has left." He said, "Who left?" He said, "He left." He said, "But he's right there." "No, no, but he's not there." And the boy told them, "If you think someone's gone, but they're right there, then who left in the first place?" Thus begins the inquiry of the spirit. Now that we understand spirit, we then try to question, what is the body? What is this body? Einstein put it very clearly. He said, "All matter is nothing but energy. All matter is made up of 99% space and 1% protons, neutrons, and electrons. And those protons, neutrons, and electrons are further made up of quarks, and those quarks are nothing but vibrations." So it is true what Krishna says. You and I, this chair, this carpet, the leaf, everything is just Krishna's cosmic dream. It's all vibrations. Which brings me to the next question. Who decides what vibration is a hand, and what vibration is this mic, and what vibration are your clothes? Who decides what vibration becomes what? These are the questions that plagued me when I was 13 years old, 14 years old. So I decided to name this deciding element the cosmic intelligence. Clearly, this cosmic intelligence has decided that despite an equal chance of dying in your sleep, you got up today. Despite that chance, all of us got up and all of us are here. Despite that chance, I got up and I'm on this stage. And my question is, why? Why are we here, and what are we doing with that? And my why is much bigger. I'm asking the big why over here. Why was I born? Why was I created? What is my purpose? And if the answer to your why is this, I respect your answer, great answer, but fact of the matter, you're not going to take it upstairs when you leave. And if you're thinking, hey, I'm going to save it up for my future generations, let me remind you that inflation and the devaluation of money are a real thing. So with the fortune that you have saved up now, your future generation will probably only afford peanuts. I have a guru, and it's a she, feminists. My guru, she says, a human being's life is represented through a dash. So to quote my guru, she says, "Tum dash ho." She says, a human is represented by their birth year and their death year, and their loving, living, laughing, crying, earning, spending, living life of all those years is represented through a dash. I guess the Hindus had figured this out a long back, and that's why they chose to cremate their people. If your answer is family, noble pursuit. I respect that. You want to take care of your family. Great. Let me remind you that even a cow can do that. A cow can take care of a family of four much better than you can. So my question is that what is the essential difference between an animal and a human being? A human has the ability of empathy, logic, and reason. So my logic, reason, and empathy told me that my ambitions need to be slightly more than that of a cow's, at least. So while I thought about that, of how to be more ambitious than a cow, I realized that I am searching. You know, we are searching for that ambition. And I like to call myself a seeker. I'm searching for answers. But in the eyes of society and parents, I am lost. As parents will tell you, and society will tell you, if you are searching for something, clearly you are lost. Bhai saab zara ambition batayenge, wo udhar milega. You are lost. And like any other lost soul in this country, I also did engineering. So while I was in Manipal and I made great friends and I had a great time studying chemical engineering, and fortunately or unfortunately, through sheer luck, I went into one of the most prestigious nuclear centers in the country. I worked at the Baba Atomic Research Center, and that's where I did my 8th semester internship, and I worked on hard water research. And my parents, they were thrilled. They were partying that our son is going to Saudi Arabia, he is going to now dig up some oil money, and he is going to be rich. And while they celebrated, my heart, my mind, and my GPA said otherwise. So I came back home without a placement, and I sat down to meditate. I had learned Sudarshan Kriya from The Art of Living then, and I was meditating. And while I was meditating, my parents pestered me to get a master's degree. And I pestered God to pester my parents. It was wonderful. We were a love triangle. It was perfect. And then somehow, I ended up joining PwC. And my principal asked me, how does a chemical engineer go to Baba Atomic Research Center and then join one of the top chartered accounting firms? I said, luck. She said, sure. And I joined PwC. I was suited, booted, wearing a tie, walking into a fancy office in CyberHub. Life was just glitzy and glamorous. We discussed Zara and CyberHub every day. It was amazing. I was happy. I was happy. But... I realized that... this is not happiness, right? I mean, I'm happy, but I'm not Beyonce. I'm not it. And what does it take to get there? How do I do more? How do I be more? How do I live more? How do I more to get there? And you see, happiness is easy. You and I were born on the shoulders of giants. Most of us in this room have been to this fancy establishment. Our parents can afford to put us into a private college anywhere across the world. We have money, cars, maids, washerwomen, food that is given to us on our table. We have everything at our disposal, and we have money at our whim to spend anywhere we like. Happiness is a choice. We can be happy now. But what I'm seeking is fulfillment. What I'm seeking is a legacy. And according to me, empathy, compassion, and service, these are the things that will build a legacy. These are the things that will raise the conscience of humanity. And that is a legacy. That is how you leave a fingerprint on humanity. And that is how you are much bigger than that tombstone. This thought process that caters to self-maximization can only be unleashed with spiritual inquiry. You have to seek the spirit. You have to seek purpose within. Because society everywhere, from your neighbor to Sharmaji across the road, to your teachers, to your own friends, to your siblings, everyone has a different view of you, but only you have a view of yourself. What are the results of my inquiry? Find meaningful living, live it, teach it, and also dance like Beyonce. These are the results of my inquiry. I decided that I want to find a meaningful living, and that this rat race of life, it doesn't make sense. That took me to Teach for India. So after PwC, I went and taught in a government school, in an all-boys school. I had a classroom of 60 children, and I taught them for 2 years. I worked to uplift the community. I worked to uplift their marks. Life suddenly had purpose. Suddenly, the ambition was greater than that of a cow, and I was loving it. Those are my kids, and that's my co-fellow Aisha Kumar. We taught these kids, and we had a wonderful time. Now, society, parents, will always be the intelligent ones, and they'll say, what about money? My neighbor once came up to me, and he said, and I'll say it in Hindi, jo tum kar rahe ho bahut acha hai, but tumhara jo pani aa raha hai na, pani. I was like, haan uncle, ye sirf haath dhone ka pani hai, nahane ka pani kab aayega? I said, inshallah, someday it'll come. I have faith in the higher power. So intelligence says money, my heart says get power, but my spirit says be like Oprah, be Oprah. My spirit literally says be Oprah. My spirit says be Beyonce. So now we move on to the second part. This was my journey of using the spirit to get to where I am. I now want to communicate that to you people. In order to get to the spiritual quotient, our journey is through the IQ, EQ, and finally the SQ. As we all know, IQ, or intelligent quotient, is a person's ability to solve problems using their cognitive intelligence. This is what the schools were designed for. The emotional intelligence is the capability of individuals to recognize their own emotion and that of others. This is my answer to the divide between IQ and EQ. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. No matter how smart you are, no matter how strong your intelligence, if you can't appeal to a person's heart, they are not going to listen to you. And finally, we get to the spiritual intelligence, our most fundamental intelligence. It is what we use to develop our capacity for meaning, vision, and value. It allows us to dream and strive. My spiritual inquiry is what led me to understand what excites me. What is it that I'm willing to give up on? Am I willing to give up on a PwC and a Baba Atomic to get to where I am? Well, yes. If I have to divide spiritual intelligence, then these are the three things: responsibility, humility, and happiness. Responsibility. Why did you wake up today? What is the purpose of your life? If you aren't asking these questions, then someone else will answer them for you. More often than not, parents. Humility. Why am I more or less than the other person? Why is it that we get to have a nice working toilet with a flush as compared to someone else who should defecate in the field? And finally, what makes me happy? Now it seems simple, right? All I have to do is work on my EQ, work on my IQ, work on my EQ, and finally get to the SQ. I can maximize myself. It seems so simple, but it's not as simple. It is not as simple. There is a struggle, and that is the roadblock of the emotional intelligence. This is what I want you all to tackle: our psychological safety and our fragile identity. All it takes to violate the identity is to invalidate it. That's all it takes. Look at patriarchy right now. All patriarchy did was invalidate a woman's rights to everything. Woman said, I have a right to freedom. No, you don't. Invalidated. Gone. Khatam. And now that feminism is trying to make its mark and fight patriarchy, they're saying you don't exist. Bad job. Literally. It is as simple as that. Ah, this is the fun part. Self, physical, emotional, and mental. We are constantly bombarded with information. You don't look good enough. Look like Kim Kardashian. You're not thin enough. Look at Kim Kardashian. You don't have as many likes. Look at Kim Kardashian. And finally, you don't have a house or a yacht and you know who to look at. Simple. They are constantly, when I say they, the system, society at whole, everyone is constantly invalidating your psychological safety that says that I am enough. I am valid. I am strong. I am capable. And society in passing will come down and say, no, you're not. And our fragile identity breaks down and destroys itself. Isn't it so simple that politics, divisive politics, gets in the way of religious harmony? All they have to do is tell religion A that religion B thinks that your religion is invalid. Simple. And that's the result. I am proud to be an Indian. Think again. These are the things that you constantly see that make you think about your national identity. And when people see these things in the news, they start having discussions saying, yaar, main Canada jana, I have to go to Canada, I have to move. I want to get out of this country. This country is not serving me. Your identity is being threatened. And finally, when you are done saying, I am tired of this trouble, I no longer want to look at any of this, I'm happy, I want to be happy. Guess what? Your morning newspaper, your Arnab Goswami, and your Facebook will constantly remind you that you are under attack, you are under threat, you are not safe. And your anyways frailing psychological safety and identity, which are anyways battered, are constantly reminded every day that you are at war with the self. Now, when the idea of gender, self-worth, religion, nation are all attacked, everything is violated, we feel pain, we suffer. How do you expect to get to your self-maximization if you're constantly attacked at the level of emotion? It's not easy. But then, there comes to rescue my man Buddha, who says, peace comes from within, do not seek it without. If your battle is outside, think again. The battle is within. In order to fight that battle within, you have to look at the simple statement. My identity is attacked. Guess what? Rethink your identity. Or as the spiritual practice teaches us, drop the identity. Detach. Detach from the ego, detach from the aham. And find peace in saying that I am not any of this, at least for those 10 seconds. Find that source of peace, build yourself up, and then go back at society. Spirituality, it's not a religion, dogma, it's not any of that. It is a practice for whoever, whenever, wherever. You can choose to like it or hate it, you can own it or disown it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't concern a spiritual person. Spirituality is what it is. It is a practice of dropping the ego to find the real self within. And when you unleash that spiritual force, it is nuclear. I'd like to conclude by quoting Khalil Gibran in saying, only when you drink from the river of silence shall you indeed sing. And when you have reached the mountaintop, then you shall begin to climb. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then you shall truly dance. I am Karthik Hariharan. I am on the spiritual path. I request you all to join me.